As John Haigh sat in the interrogation room with the detective, he could feel an itch inside. He had to tell him. He had to let everyone know what he had done. He felt superior and secure in his methods of disposing his victims. He looked at the detective and said, "If I told you the truth, you would not believe me. It sounds too fantastic for belief. Mrs. Durand Deacon no longer exists. She has disappeared completely, and no trace of her can ever be found again. I have destroyed her with acid. How can you prove murder without a body?" What followed was a long confession, but to truly explore the life and crimes of John George Haigh, we need to go back to the beginning, to the birth of a fucking monster. John George Haigh was born on July 24th, 1909. He was brought up by his parents John Robert and Emily Haigh, but it wasn't a regular upbringing. His parents were members of a strict religious sect called the Plymouth Brethren, and one thing that was important to them was to keep the members separated from the outside world. When John Haigh was still young, the family moved to a village outside Yorkshire, and there his father, John Robert, would build a 10-foot fence around the estate, all to keep the world away, and to keep little John isolated. But John Haigh had one escape. He was allowed to attend school and the choir, and he quickly gained an interest for music, specifically playing the piano. But even though he was allowed certain activities, it was fucking with his head. Why did his parents allow him to participate in such sinful activities? Regardless of why, John Haigh did enjoy being in the choir, and he would later state that it was at this point, when he saw Jesus Christ bleeding on the cross, that his bloodlust was waking up. He also had nightmares of being in a forest of crucifixes, all dripping with blood. John grew up and went through a few jobs, but he saw an easier way to make the money he needed. He just needed to grab it. But his stealing didn't go unnoticed, and he was fired from the job he had at the time. The year was now 1934, and John had grown to use fraud to steal money. A complicated way to be a thief, but John thought himself to be smarter and better than everyone around him, a trait he shares with many serial killers, even the stupid ones. But it was that year that he met a 21-year-old woman named Beatrice. The two fell in love and married, but John kept his lifestyle of fraud going. And so 4 months into the marriage, the police came and arrested John. He was sent to prison for fraud, and his now pregnant wife decided to put the baby they were going to have up for adoption. John would only see Beatrice one more time, and he never saw his daughter. Once John got out, he had a new plan. He was going to sell cars that were still subject to lease, but that scam only lasted a few months. He was once again arrested, and he was once again put in prison. While doing time, the sect he had grown up in excommunicated John, and when he got out, he decided to get an honest job. He went to work for a dry cleaning business, something he actually liked doing, but his attempts at an honest work were crushed when his business partner died in a motorcycle accident. John had had enough of this place. He packed up his stuff and moved to London, planning new scams and new frauds. But it started out pretty good for John Haigh. He got a job as a chauffeur for a wealthy young man and became close friends with the man, something that got him higher up in the hierarchy and eventually landed him in a position as manager. But he had his own plans and left the business. He was going to start his own business. Another scam, of course. John would advertise estates that were to be disposed of, and when the checks came in, he cashed them. But the customers never got any estate for it. John was playing a dangerous game, and his stupid scam earned him 4 years in prison. The 4 years went by, and as soon as John got out of the joint, he was caught again for theft. He was shipped back again to prison on a 21-month sentence. But John didn't want to give up. He just needed a better plan. He knew he could pull it off, he just needed to do it flawlessly. At some point when he was locked up, he started obsessing over the concept of corpus delicti, something he would tell his inmates meant that if there was no corpse to be found, then he could not be guilty of murder. The seed had been planted inside John's head. A seed of murder. John Haigh started experimenting on his plans of using acid while inside prison. He would steal sulfuric acid from the prison's tin shop, and he would catch rats and mice that he would experiment on. He noted how powerful the acid was. Perfect, he must have thought to himself. Because in his mind, if he could murder and destroy the remains, he would be untouchable. John Haigh was released from prison and got a real job. At this job, he met a young woman named Barbara that he got engaged to, despite still being legally married to his previous wife. Then in 1944, John Haigh suffered an injury to his head when he was involved in a car accident. Unfortunately, he didn't die, but he later stated that when the wound dripped blood from his head into his mouth, that he regained his lust for blood that he had once had when he was a child. And while that may have been an attempt at an insanity defense, 1944 was his first year of murder. He was finally going to put his plans into use. But he had never killed anyone before, so it would have to take a great opportunity for John to draw his first blood. By 1944, John Haigh had moved to a basement apartment, and while out and about in the local pub on the night of August 9th, 1944, he met an old friend. The friend was the wealthy young man he had been a private driver for. His name was Mac McSwan, and Mac had no idea that reigniting this friendship would be a devastating decision. The two went on with their friendship for a month, because on September 9th, 1944, Mac would disappear. Mac and John had been sitting in John's apartment when he suddenly felt a lust for blood. John in that moment snapped. He picked up a table leg and struck it with everything he had down on Mac's head. Mac didn't die of the blow to the head, but he was knocked out. John then picked up a sharp knife and a mug. He walked over to Mac's unconscious body and slit his throat. While the blood and life of Mac was pouring out from the slit in his throat, John held the mug under the red stream. Once John had cached the blood in the mug, he drank it. He then left his apartment and started planning on how to dispose of Mac's body. He was able to take a 40-gallon drum from a bomb site nearby and return to the apartment basement. He proceeded to shove and push and stuff Mac's stale body into the drum, and once he had done so, he put on his protective glasses and his protective gloves. Once he was ready and prepared, he began filling the drum with acid. But it wasn't as easy as he had imagined it would be. Using acid on rats was one thing, but when he used it on his one-time close friend, he had to take several breaks as the fumes were so strong. And when the acid came into contact with the body, it got searing hot. After many pauses, John was finally exhausted by his attempts. He put a cover on the drum and left the body to be dissolved, turning his friend Mac into a liquid sludge. 2 days had gone by when John returned to the drum in the basement. He opened it to see if there was any trace of Mac left, and while the smell was horrific, he was glad. All he could see was a dark sludge with red streaks. He started stirring the contents of the drum just to make sure, and while it was thick, he managed to pour it down a manhole. Although there was pieces of flesh stuck to the bottom of the drum, he managed to get those down too. He had done it. He had killed someone and destroyed them. Now there was no proof of murder, he thought. He was on top of the world. Now with a wealthy young man dead and destroyed, he would claim his property. So John Haigh visited Mac's parents and told them that their son had gone into hiding to not be drafted into the army, an idea Mac had voiced to his parents before. With this lie and his close friendship with Mac, the parents had no problems believing the story. But John was planning to kill them too. But this time he was going to use a mask. The fumes had been horrific. While using a drum was effective, it was too hard to stuff a corpse into it. So he purchased a steel tub. It was now July 2nd, 1945, and John Haigh invited Mac's parents to his apartment. They hadn't been there for long before John picked up a blunt object and slammed it into their heads, knocking them both out. Quickly, precisely, and deadly. He then got his sharp knife and a mug, and slit the two elderly McSwan's throats. As he did, he let the mug fill up from the streams of their blood, and then he drank it. Then he carried them down into the basement, and one at a time he threw them into the steel tub and filled it with acid, turning them both into a sludgy mess of melted flesh, bones, organs, and streaks of red, thick blood. After he was done, he poured the sludge that had once been two living, breathing human beings into the manhole. No remorse. No regret. Now he just had to falsify some papers to transfer the McSwan property into his name. Something he did, and something that earned him over £6,000. A sum of money that was worth a lot back then. John got a room at a hotel. There was a lot of elderly widows living there. Easy scams for John. A couple of years had now passed since the murders and eradication of the McSwan family, and he was ready to kill again. All the money he had gotten out of that was now gone. He had used it all. John went to the classified ads in the papers where he saw a house for sale by a prominent doctor named Archibald Henderson. John contacted Archibald, but he had no intentions of buying the house. All he wanted was to get into Archibald's life, become closer to him, so that he could kill him and his wife, and falsify more papers to take their money as well. And so he met Archibald and pretended to be interested while getting closer to the doctor. Eventually, the house sale fell through, but he had reached his objective. He was now a close friend of both Archibald and his wife Rose. While John Haigh was getting to know the couple and learning of their families and of their economy, he had bought a workshop where he had moved all his tools of murder, dusting off the steel tub that had once destroyed two people. In February of 1948, John spent several days with Rose and Archibald, and on February 12th, John brought Archibald Henderson to his workshop. John had stolen Archibald's revolver previously, and once they entered the workshop, he just raised the revolver to Archibald's head and shot him point blank. Again, no remorse, no regret, just a cold machine. John left Archibald on the wooden floor and drove to Rose. He told Rose that her husband had fallen ill and that she needed to come with him fast. She went with him to the workshop, and once inside, John once again pulled out his gun and shot Rose in the head. Now they were both dead. He had by now gotten two tubs for dispatching the Hendersons, and so he slit their throats and drank their blood, and then he threw them both into tubs and poured the acid inside. He left them there in the workshop to be dissolved overnight. He returned the following day and threw the sludge into the corner of his yard, but it wasn't all a sludge. One foot was sitting there still intact, but a foot wasn't too hard to get rid of. After he had done his dirty business, he falsified more papers for the Henderson's estate and cars, and this time earned £8,000. A huge sum. But John was a fucking mess. He gambled away all the money in record time, and attempted to lure several more potential victims to his workshop. All his attempts failed until Mrs. Duran Deacon came along in February of 1949. She was an elderly widow who lived in the same hotel as John, and he told her to come see his process for manufacturing false fingernails. Once in the workshop, John told her to sit down and presented her with some papers to read. As she read the words, John stood behind her and pulled out his gun. He shot her in the head, killing her instantly. Then he pulled out his penknife and slashed her throat. He drank her blood and threw her in the tub, dissolving the woman in acid. His sixth and final victim. Only a day passed before concerned friends and relatives of Mrs. Durant Deacon reported her missing to the police. John played along and thought he had everyone outsmarted, but when one of the detectives looked into his past, filled with frauds and scams, he knew that this guy might be more than what he lets on. After finding some of Mrs. Durant Deacon's possessions in John's house, he was arrested. John didn't say anything. But when he was left alone with a detective in the room, he started talking. He gave details of what he had done and of the people he had killed, but he had a smirk. He said that he couldn't be tried for murder because there was no body left. And no body means no evidence. The detectives contacted Scotland Yard. This many murders was too much for them to handle, a serial killer before the term even existed. But the forensic investigator for Scotland Yard did find remains in the sludge. He found 28 pounds of human fat, 3 gallstones, a part of a foot, 18 bone fragments, and a set of dentures. John George Haigh was fucked. He tried his best for an insanity plea, but his pleas fell on deaf ears. The examinations of his claims proved that he was not insane. He was very much aware, and he was a cold-blooded murderer. The jury only spent 15 minutes debating and contemplating before they found John Haigh guilty. And so a meeting had been set up. John George Haigh had a meeting with the hangman. And the hangman he met when he went to the gallows on June 6th, 1949. There he was hung by the neck, executed. But before his execution, his face was fitted for death mask at Madame Tussaud's Chamber of Horrors. The only condition was that his mask was to always be kept in perfect condition. So as he swung from the gallows, he knew that he would always live on in infamy.